Chapter 15, Israel's New Heroes. Israel loves America. They look to the USA as the land of opportunity. They see it as a great place to shop, so much so that Israelis visiting the US bring an empty suitcase for the new clothes they'll buy and bring home. Israel also eats up American television. They love Seinfeld, The Simpsons, Sex and the City, the list goes on and on. One day, Asaf Harel, an actor and writer in Israel, was watching an episode of the HBO original series Entourage. If you're not familiar with it, the show is about a kid from Queens who makes it huge in Hollywood, becoming a big star. His older brother was already a B-list actor, but he also brings his two closest friends to California with him. One becomes his manager, the other runs the homes where the four live together in some of Southern California's nicest neighborhoods. Harel was watching reruns of the show when news came in that Mirabilis, the company behind the instant messaging computer program known as ICQ, had been bought by AOL for $287 million and another $120 million in deferred payments. It was the most anyone had ever paid for an Israeli company by far. Israelis were absolutely captivated, and they quickly learned the background of this incredible company and the reason for its great market value. Mirabilis was founded by five Israelis in 1996. Four were friends, the fifth was Yossi Vardi, now a legendary investor in Israel and the father of one of the original four. They decided to come up with instant messaging after realizing that the technology existed, but that nobody was even really experimenting with it. Their goal was to be able to connect computer users using Microsoft Windows operating system. Harel says, when Mirabilis was sold, it was a substantial event for the young people of this country, in fact, for everyone in Israel. A few guys created something on their own and sold it for hundreds of millions. This has never happened before in Israel. We had never had young millionaires, especially ones creating their own wealth. I remember how enthusiastic everyone in the country was about it. And I thought, if all of Israel were so interested in reading about it, they would likely watch a show about it. Since then, this kind of entrepreneurship has happened over and over, but we were the first to really turn it into a popular culture event. Harel took the storyline of the young Israeli millionaires and applied the success factors of the American series. Entourage was a dude series, dudes walking and talking. ICQ gave us the context for Entourage, Israeli style. He and his friends began writing immediately after getting the idea. A few months later, the show was given the green light and they started shooting in 2005. Harel is the idea man for the show, but also one of the stars portraying Guy Fogel, the most serious of the four main characters. The show is called Mesudarim. In English, that title would translate to something like Settled for Life. The show is a dramatic comedy about how the four friends lived their lives after selling their high-tech company to an American firm for $217 million. The four friends buy a mansion together. They're in each other's business over women, over money, and over how they can possibly take the next step together in business. Mesudarim quickly became Israel's highest-rated comedy series. Harel is a smart and savvy producer, director, writer, and actor. He knows the country very well, and that helped him capture the essence of how Israel was changing. He saw that it was becoming a society that so values entrepreneurship and technology that he could turn a multi-million dollar technology sale into a TV series. And he astutely realized that the country's heroes had shifted. It used to be that Sayeret Matkal, Israel's special forces, was the unit that everyone strived to be in, he explains. They were our heroes. They were the stars, people like Ariel Sharon from Unit 101 in the Paratroopers, Ehud Barak and Benjamin Netanyahu, who were both from Sayeret Matkal. They were our special clubs. But now it's the high-tech units that are most revered, 8200 and especially Talpiot. Israelis recognize high-tech players the way Americans recognize athletes and celebrities. Harel believes the changes in Israeli society were born from the dissolution of the Yom Kippur War in 1973. Years ago, fighters created an identity for Israel. Everyone went into army service and it used to tell you who you were going to be. But after that war, the nation started to change. We went from an emphasis on brawn to an emphasis on brains. Talpiot and those other thinking units represent Israel's global contribution to innovation. Brains are the new passport to global society. So now these 8200s and Talpiot graduates are our new heroes. The battle between brains and brawn, individualism and the common good, soldier and executive, has existed in Israel from the very beginning. For decades, that battle manifested itself in the rivalry between Yitzhak Rabin and Shimon Peres. Many in the world always saw the two Israeli political giants as allies, but everyone in Israel knew otherwise. Rabin and Peres hated each other. Rabin was a fighter, the general. Peres was never a soldier, but he was one of Israel's first executives in the Ministry of Defense. Fighters were taught to not trust people who didn't fight, and Peres resented that attitude. There was this everlasting tension between their two different approaches, and they were always up against each other in the Labour Party. It was uniforms versus suits. Asaf Harel sees Talpiot's success in both in the IDF and in Israeli culture as the ultimate win for Peres. Until recently, Israel was still in the era of the fighter, he affirms. Now we're moving on. Asaf also believes it won't be long before the soldiers who were in elite technology units like Talpiot will take on political roles in the country, perhaps even the office of Prime Minister. Talpiot's success is also evidence of Israel's rotation from a socialist society to a much more capitalistic society. As one who watches Israeli society and culture closely, Asaf's take is that money is now more important than ever in Israel. But Israel is far from the only country where money is more important than it once was. That's certainly true in the United States and the Western world. That's just the way things are. There's no use in judging it. You just do your best. You could argue that this development is good because it promotes education. People strive to be better educated, they earn higher wages, and donations for charitable causes come from that money. That being said, his next project for Israeli TV is the opposite of Masudarim. It's about old men sitting in a cafe all day, griping about their lives. With the changes in societal attitudes comes new popularity for Talpiot recruits. Many members of Talpiot say that after they enlist in the unit, it's amazing how many teenagers from their old neighborhoods and high schools take the time to find their phone numbers. They call them to ask about what they're doing and about their path to Talpiot. Saar Cohen is from Hadera, just north of Tel Aviv, and is the first student from Hadera High School sent to Talpiot. "Young kids track me down," says Cohen with dismay. "They ask what will happen to me in Talpiot. How do I get in?" Obviously, they're on something. They want not only the education, the training, and the prestige of the program. They want the added benefit of being able to say for the rest of their lives that they are part of the Talpiot elite. The rewards are many. Chapter 16, Talpiots Need Only Apply.